from the National Hot Rod Association, Champion Jeep Drag Racing, the 23rd annual NHRA Winston Vinyl. Speeds in excess of 280 miles per hour. Covering the quarter mile distance in less than 6 seconds. Drag Racing from the NHRA. The 14th National Event NHRA Winston Championship Trail starts and finishes in Pomona, California. 9 months ago, it all began right here at the Los Angeles County Fairgrounds. Since then, two of the three professional world titles have been won. In the 13th race of the year, Bob Glidden clinched his unprecedented 8th Winston Pro Stock crown. The deciding race came in the first round of the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals at Firebird Raceway in Phoenix when Glidden beat Joe Lapone. Funny Car World title was won at the Texas Motorplex in the first round of the Chief Auto Parts Nationals. By defeating Scott Coletta, Kenny Bernstein won his third consecutive world championship and the season-ending $100,000 bonus check. Today, the series concludes on this historic quarter-mile track, and the remaining professional title, Top Fuel Eliminator, is still up for grabs. Hello, everybody. I'm Dave McClelland, and after a year-long struggle, it is a tooth-and-nail battle between two drivers. In NHRA competition, each round win is worth 200 points, plus bonus points for low ET and top speed of the event. After a year-long struggle, only 160 points separate number one from number two. Today is the day that the Top Fuel Eliminator World Championship will be decided. For more on that story, here's Steve Evans.
Well, Dave, the Top Fuel World Championship comes down to a battle between two men in two cars. Behind me, Joe Amato, Old Forge, Pennsylvania. His car crewed by the famed Tim Richards. They've been in 7 national event final rounds. They have won 3 of those. They come to Pomona with a 1-round points advantage over, ironically, the car pitted right next door to them. Now, this car has been in 6 final rounds and has won 5 of them. And, of course, I'm talking about, from Lansing, Michigan, Dick LaHaye. His Top Fuel dragster crewed by his daughter, Kim. Now, the first time these two got together this year, and there have been some memorable battles we'll look back on right now. That was in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. The final round, Amato LaHaye. Dick LaHaye won his first event of the year by the narrowest of margins. Moved on to the final round of the all-important U.S. Nationals. There again, the win went by the narrowest of margins, but this time to Joe Amato, who got off the starting line first. Maybe the most pressure-packed of all their meetings this season came a few weeks ago, Phoenix, Arizona, the semifinal round of the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals. Again, it was Amato off the starting line by a few hundredths first, but Dick LaHaye had the power to drive around the big red car from Pennsylvania and won by a matter of inches. Now, yesterday here, that kind of competition between these two men continued. A non-points event for $50,000, the Prager Weld-Wheel Top Fuel Classic, and it was a classic. The quickest side-by-side drag in history, Joe Amato, 5'11", defeated Dick LaHaye, 5'12". This morning, before competition began, I talked to both men. For almost 30 years, you've been working towards this day. How do you feel?
I feel great. I mean, we're ready for this thing. It's built up to it over the whole season, and with the races that Joe and I have had, and it should be the two best cars in the country running for this world championship, and that's what's happening right now. And
if it's not to be, can the team handle that disappointment should it come?
Oh, certainly. We have done better than we've ever done in our life, and if we don't win the world championship, that means we'll just have to try a little harder next year.
Joe, unlike Dick LaHaye, you've been in this situation before. You won the world title in 84. How has this title chase been different?
Well, it's a lot tighter. There's a lot more cars running better, and it's going to be a lot more rewarding at the end because the competition is so great, and we're coming down to a shootout at the OK Corral.
Well, if both those men sounded ready and confident to you, you're absolutely right, because they both survived round one earlier today. Final preparations being made right now for round number two. David?
Steve, this is not only a battle between two race cars and two great drivers, but between two great crew chiefs. This is Kim LaHaye, the crew chief on the family-operated Dick LaHaye Top Fuel Dragster. In the pit next door, Tim Richards turning the wrenches with his crew on Joe Amato's Top Fuel car. It boils down to two teams racing for the $100,000 season-ending bonus. The NHRA Winston Finals is being brought to you by Goodyear, the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company. No matter how far you go, Goodyear takes you home. And by Bram Bendix Autolite, which are all quality products of Allied Automotive. Top Fuel action from the Winston Final. At the Los Angeles County Fairgrounds in Pomona, California, we're at the NHRA Winston Finals in round number two of Top Fuel Eliminator. Here is one of the competitors locked in that battle for the Winston Top Fuel Championship, Joe Amato. In this second round race, he'll be going against Frank Bradley.
And if Bradley defeats Amato, of course, then Joe is on the sidelines hoping that Dick LaHaye does not survive this round and become the world champion. So there's a lot of cards here. Who could be the spoiler as far as this $100,000 battle is concerned?
The side-by-side burnout designed to heat up those huge racing slicks to get them as hot as possible to provide the traction necessary to couple some 3,000 horsepower to this fabled racetrack. A huge crowd on hand under crystal clear skies to watch this race, which concludes an exciting season of NHRA championship competition. Frank Bradley, formerly of Napa, California, has recently moved to the Los Angeles area to the city of Orange. In his first round race, Bradley beat Earl Whiting, currently number 10 in the point standing. Joe Amato, meantime, defeated rookie Dan Fitzgerald in his first round race.
How much interest has there been in this shootout between Amato and Dick LaHaye? Well, 1 hour after sunrise this morning, as Joe Amato warmed up his 3,000 horsepower racing engine, a huge crowd surrounded the team. Everybody intently listening to that engine, jumping a little bit as Joe would whack the throttle. They are as excited about this race, Dave, as I've ever seen the fans here at the Winston Finals.
Without a doubt, this season-long battle between Amato and LaHaye for the Top Fuel World Championship could have been scripted by a Hollywood screenwriter. In fact, if each driver makes it past the second round of competition, they will meet in the semifinals for the World Championship. Dick and Kim LaHaye look on intently as Joe Amato stages oh so carefully against Frank Bradley. And a good start for Amato. Bradley smokes the tires, and Amato is into the semifinals. His elapsed time, 5.24 seconds. His speed, over 280 miles an hour.
With Joe Amato now safely into the semifinals, it means this man, Dick LaHaye, strapped in, engine being started, has to defeat that car to stay in the hunt for the world title. And that may be not as difficult as it could be, in that that is a team car. Larry Miner, the team owner, races Dick LaHaye in identical-looking cars.
Steve, Dick LaHaye has got to be remembering a race back in 1983, the Cajun Nationals, when Larry Miner raced another teammate. At that time, it was Gary Beck in the finals of Top Fuel Eliminator. Beck was going for the world championship, but surprise of all, Larry Miner defeated Gary Beck in that final round race. Beck eventually went on to win the world championship, but it was certainly no thanks to Miner's efforts on that day in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. While the burnout procedures continue, let's check in at the far end of the track.
Well, Joe Amato comes one round closer to what may be the inevitable side-by-side race with Dick LaHaye, a 5:24, Joe.
Well, the weather got a little worse, Steve. The air went up about 500 feet, so I guess that's decent. We'll have to wait and see what Dick can run, but we're just happy to be in this third round and get a chance to go heads up, because that's the only way it should be. For a world championship, $100,000, it should be head-to-head. I think that's going to be the race of the year.
Oh, boy, would that be the race of the year? It could happen in one more round of racing. Here's one of the potential competitors, Dick LaHaye. We know Joe Amato is in the semis. LaHaye, in his first round race, defeated three-time Winston champ Shirley Muldowney, while Larry Miner defeated Jack Ostrander. And the question is, will Larry Miner race against Dick LaHaye?
Your team owner, Larry Miner, has won in the first round. You face him in the second round. What's going to happen there?
We're just going to go race far. That's what it amounts to. We discussed it earlier, and if we're going to win this world championship, we've got to beat everybody there, and he's going to have to be one of them.
Well, if you believe that, I'll buy you, sell you a bridge.
Well, you've heard from both LaHaye and Amato about the situation. Obviously, the Larry Minor car is being prepared to go to the starting line against his own teammate. And Larry, even the most loyal Amato fan wouldn't blame you if this car didn't move from the pits.
Steve, this is really a hard decision. I've talked to my guys and I've talked to LaHaye about it. And really, they kind of want to race for it. We know what's at stake here. And it's a hard decision, but we're tuning the car up to take it to the line. And we don't really know what's going to happen. We're just going to play it out.
Well, I got the feeling, Dave, that Larry Minor feels he owes it to the fans to put two cars on the starting line. But maybe he also owes it to the fans to not deprive them of a head-to-head Amato LaHaye race in the semis.
Dick LaHaye in the near lane, Larry Minor in the far lane. The cars identical in their appearance. And LaHaye goes up in smoke. Minor's out in front, and then he backs off. And Dick LaHaye gets the break of a lifetime. 5.59 seconds. He doesn't care what the elapsed time is. All he knows is he got to the finish line first, and that puts him into that classic semifinal battle against Joe Amato, with the world championship at stake. As we look again, in the far lane is Minor. You can see him pull ahead as Dick LaHaye smokes the tires. And then Minor realizes what's happened. He shuts it off, and smoking the tires and all, Dick LaHaye streaks by to take the win. Coming back up the return road, one of the combatants in the Winston Championship for Top Fuel Eliminator, Joe Amato, waving to this huge crowd. Here's Steve.
Well, as we all saw, Dick LaHaye smoked the tires, may have hurt a motor, but fortunately you were racing your teammate, and believe me, no one blames this team for working together here. It had to happen.
Well, you know, it's one of those things that we tried to step it up and just see how quick we could run, and obviously the track wouldn't hold it. Just thank God it worked out the way that it did.
But would you have dared gamble that racing anybody else?
No, I wouldn't have. You know, it may be the thing that we needed.
No, you haven't hurt many parts. This one could be hurt a little bit.
It may be. It smoked the tires, and I pedaled it a couple times out there, and it just wouldn't hook back up.
If every run down a racetrack is a learning process, Dick LaHaye may have just gone to graduate school. Back in the pit area, Ed McCulloch is preparing the third car in the Minor Racing Team, the Oldsmobile Funny Car, for his round of competition here at the Winston Finals. The crowd giving their cheers to Dick LaHaye as he returns back to the pits to get his car ready to race against Joe Amato for the Winston World Championship title. The quickest man in the history of the sport, Darryl Gwynn, approaching the burnout area with his super long Budweiser special.
In fact, that is the longest car the drag racing sport has ever seen. It's also the quickest in the world, the official record holder at 5.08 seconds. And Darryl was a factor in this world championship until one race ago. His opponent is Connie Coletta. And Coletta has had a miserable year. Not only has he not won a race, he has won very few rounds of competition, but he never gives up. Coletta in the far lane in the Coletta Flying Services Special.
Steve, that car is part of the two-car team fielded by Coletta, his own Top Fuel dragster, his son Scott's funny car.
Darryl Gwynn told me this morning, David, that he was as interested a spectator of that race between LaHaye and Amato as any of us. But his intent today was to win over the field and pick up over $20,000 with the Winston Finals Eliminator title. Darryl Gwynn, he's just looking for some cash flow today.
In fact, Darryl Gwynn is the defending champion of this event, winning it last season in his first round race today. He defeated Mike Brotherton. Connie Coletta defeated Dan Pastorini, who happened to lose a blower belt in his first round race. Coletta utilizing a canopy over the cockpit to protect him from the buffeting winds at speeds over 270 miles an hour. Darryl Gwynn used to use one of those canopies, but he put this car on a super diet after the first of the season. He lost about 200 pounds off of the car weight and instantly picked up performance. And problems for Connie Coletta, a minor fire. Coletta slows, Gwynn wins the race. Time for Gwynn, a 5.21 seconds, 275 mile an hour charge. It seemed to be just a bit of an oil fire in the rear of the engine on Connie Coletta's Top Fuel dragster. No great problems for him. As we look again, after they left the starting line, Coletta was alongside Gwynn. Then the difficulties began. You see the flames coming out the back of the engine. Coletta's car slowing. Gwynn speeding on to over 275 miles an hour. And a second round win here at the Winston Finals.
Well, Dick LaHaye told us that he went up and tried to run in the teens and the track wouldn't hold it. Darrell Gwynn, I think you knew it wouldn't hold it, a 521.
Yeah, that's right. Matter of fact, I had to hold the brake off the starting line pretty hard because it smoked the tires on the dry. So this heat is what's gotten to the racetrack. The rubber's gotten real soft, so we're going to have to play a little game here third round and try and get down this tricky surface. But for the final, you know, whoever makes it to the final, it's going to be good and hard because the sun will go down. So that's what we're hoping on, is to creep our way into the final, and then we can put our power back in it.
Like everyone else, you've been watching this LaHaye Amato thing with great interest. What do you think now that they're going to face each other?
I think that everybody's better stand on their feet, including myself. I'm going to watch this one.
Okay. No favorite?
No, I'm not going to say.
Okay. Darrell Gwynn goes to the semis.
The number three man in the points chase for that world championship, Darrell Gwynn, was in the hunt up until one race ago. On the starting line, two veteran Top Fuel Dragster drivers. In the lane nearest the camera, out of Lone Star Racing, is the Texan, Eddie Hill from Wichita Falls. This is the mob, driven by Ed Moore.
Ed Moore from San Bernardino, California, just a few miles down Interstate 10 from Pomona. I guess you could call them local races. They don't follow the national event tour. They also have a short wheelbase fuel altered car that they use that same engine in for match racing. They have a lot of fun drag racing. And to beat the world's fastest driver, which indeed Eddie Hill is, would be a big thrill for the mob team. In round number one, Eddie Hill got by Gary Ormsby, while Ed Moore was defeating Ray Stutz. Now, Ray Stutz, who drives right here in Pomona, has not had good luck at his home track. At the Winter Nationals, his parachute failed, and he crashed the car into the net at the far end. He wasn't hurt, but the car was.
Then, in his first round race today against Ed Moore, Ray Stutz had disaster strike once again. A huge engine explosion, a fall of flames streaming out from behind the car. Stutz was able to keep the car pointed straight down the racetrack. He very calmly brought it to a safe stop, uninjured in this engine explosion and fire. But of course, is racing season over?
Well, on this particular racetrack, the scariest thing that can happen with a blower fire like that is to get the parachutes, because the shutdown area is a little on the short side. But Ray, the parachutes did their job and you're okay.
Yeah, we're fine. You know, we've had pretty rough year this year starting out here at the Winter Nationals. We crashed a car, and so we're just happy to be that we qualified number eight and did real well here. I don't know what we did just now, but things went a lot better than they did last year.
Indeed they did. Let's hope you find the gremlins that caused those superchargers to go away on you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Ray Stutz, tough competitor. He won't quit.
The man that defeated Ray Stutz in the first round, Ed Moore, is facing quite a challenge. He has got to defeat Eddie Hill. This is truly one of the fastest race cars in the world. Eddie Hill holds the national record at over 285 miles an hour.
And Eddie Hill has been drag racing either on land or water for almost 30 years. And Ed Moore has seen just about everything that drag racing sport has to offer as well. Has competed in a variety of classes over the years, and now in the fastest of them all, Top Fuel Dragster.
Both drivers now beginning to concentrate on the staging procedure. They roll their cars forward until the front wheels break an electronic beam across the starting line. That lights the little stage and pre-stage lights at the top of the tree, indicates they're ready. Ed Moore had the jump, but then smoked his tires, and Eddie Hill streaks on for the win. Hill with a 5.24 second elapsed time. His speed only 269 miles an hour, indicating a rather slow speed for Eddie Hill, but good enough to win and advance him into the semifinal round of competition, where he will race Darrell Gwynn, the quickest car in the country against the fastest car. Gwynn having the lane choice. Dick LaHaye against Joe Amato. Who wins this one will determine who is your world champion. Amato has the choice of lanes by virtue of a quicker elapsed time. Joe Amato playing with his dog Giuseppe as they get ready for that semifinal race against Dick LaHaye at the Winston Final.
The Pro Stock Thunderbird of seven-time NHRA champion Bob Glidden uses...
At the NHRA Winston Finals at the Los Angeles County Fairgrounds, Kim LaHaye is directing the work being performed on the Top Fuel Dragster, driven by her father, Dick. They all know that the single run with Joe Amato will determine who will be the Top Fuel World Champion. Here is the other team car in the Miller American Racing Team. This is the Oldsmobile Forenza-bodied car of Ed McCullough. Racing against McCulloch in his second round of funny car competition is the man out of Dallas, Texas, that has got one of the most recognizable marathon occurs in the sport, that of the Blue Max of Raymond Beadle.
Raymond Beadle will retire as a funny car driver at the end of this race, Dave. The Kodiak team will be back next year with a young driver, he says, yet to be named. Just too many business obligations for Raymond.
While competition continues here at the Winston Finals in Funny Car Eliminator, the World Championship title has long been decided. That category has been dominated for the last three seasons by one man, Kenny Bernstein and the Budweiser King.
But David, early this morning, there was trouble in paradise. We, along with several hundred fans, were drawn to the Kenny Bernstein pit area by a giant cloud of smoke.
Kenny, the crew just routinely warming up the car, and suddenly the entire area is engulfed in smoke. What happened?
Well, for something siphoning nitro, we were actually on alcohol just warming it up, and something was siphoning nitro into the engine, and it wouldn't shut off, so we had to use the fire extinguisher to kill the motor, to put it in the injector to you know, squeeze her down and make her die.
Well, we don't have much time before first round. Is this going to entail taking the engine apart or what?
I don't think so. Dale will take care of it. We'll find where it's siphoning out right now, what line's not doing what it's supposed to do, and I don't think it'll have to come apart. I hope not.
Thank you, Kim.
We stayed in the Bernstein camp and watched Dale Armstrong, the most publicized drag racing crew chief ever, as he sorted his way through this maze of lines, and he found it. A stuck check valve, the Budweiser King was in the lane for the first round.
A graphic example of why Kenny Bernstein has been so dominant over these last three seasons.
As we move back to the starting line, we look at the blue car of Raymond Beadle. Don't you know he would like to leave the sport as a winner? He's been runner-up at the last two NHRA championship events and, of course, a three-time world champion.
He's racing against Ed McCulloch, who had a great 5.45 second elapsed time to defeat Bruce Larson in the first round.
And as we look at McCulloch's Oldsmobile body car in the far lane, bear in mind he's the world record holder at 5.36 seconds. This is a rematch of the final round at the Chief Auto Parts Texas Nationals just a month ago, where it was McCulloch over Raymond Beadle. It's a good start by both drivers. McCulloch forward to the head at half track, and it is Ed McCulloch all the way at 5.51 seconds.
Raymond Beadle slowing to a 6.25 second elapsed time, putting a cap on a brilliant career of a great driver out of Dallas, Texas, Raymond Beadle. For Ed McCulloch, he advances into the semifinals. Now on the starting line, our next pair, getting fired and ready to go. This is the bright red and white machine of the Motorcraft Thunderbird of Candies and Hughes, Mark Oswald driving. This car has been absolutely the performance leader over the last three races. His elapsed time has been down in the 540s. He came into this event as the number one qualifier with a great 5.35 second elapsed time. He's racing against the patriarch of the Dunn racing family. This is Jim Dunn. Let's go to the far end of the racetrack, Steve, with Ed McCulloch.
Well, Ed, from the 540s and now into the 550s. The weather, the track, what?
Probably mostly the racetrack. Everybody's a little bit cautious, you know. It's warmed up a little bit today from what we've been running in, and you know, you don't want to overcome the racetrack. So, you know, it was a little bit soft there, but you know, got on down through there, and we'll play it by ear.
Back on the starting line, Mark Oswald continuing to prepare himself and his race car for this second round race. In the first round, he had a great 5.43 second elapsed time when he defeated the Australian Graham Cowan. Meantime, Jim Dunn defeated Kenny Bernstein. That's right, the world champion went out of competition in the first round in this race. Dunn and Bernstein left the starting line together, and then Bernstein went up in smoke, ending his racing day.
Well, for the final time this season, we talked to Kenny Bernstein, the world champion again, but the year, Kenny, ending less auspiciously than you would have liked.
Oh, sure, Steve, obviously. The last four races, not being competitive or being competitive, but not being there and winning like we had at the early part. And it's nice for, you know, Budweiser, Quaker State, and Buick to win the championship and for Winston and all that. But
you know, you want to go out high because it's a long winter, and the winter months are tough when you're a little down.
Well, Winston has $100,000 at a banquet tomorrow night. That should tide you over the winter. Your problems here, were they related to the pit problem this morning?
No, it shook real hard. It just overpowered the racetrack. It shook real hard and then knocked the tire loose. There just wasn't much we could do with it. It's no one's fault. We had it up there to run. We had Oswald the next round. He had ran a 5:43. We got to get competitive with him, so we had to take a chance, and it just didn't hold.
Thank you for a lot of thrills this season.
Well, I want to thank all the fans for giving us the thrills they give us. We all appreciate it. Dale Armstrong and the whole crew, all of us do.
Take a vacation, will you?
I wish I could.
Nobody works harder as either a businessman or a racer than Kenny Bernstein, the world champion for 1987. Jim Dunn coming into the staging beams, as is his competitor, Mark Oswald.
And David, there were rumors that Mark Oswald might not be back next season with this team. I can dispel those right now. Paul Candies has signed Mark Oswald to another contract to drive that Thunderbird.
And that's good news for everyone. Oh, they're both up in smoke. This is a battle of who can recover first, and it's Mark Oswald. He regains the traction and drives it through. And there was the case of the driver winning the race. The performance had nothing to do with it. How about a 6:42? He did drive it to 250 knotted miles an hour, indicating he kept his foot on that throttle all the way through the quarter-mile racetrack. When they left the starting line, both cars lost traction. The smoke you see coming off the back of the cars indicates burning rubber. Then, as Jim Dunn tried to recover, Mark Oswald did the same. He recovered first and was able to pull ahead and take the important second-round victory to move into the semifinals. Meantime, in the Amato pit, wife Jerry, working right alongside her husband, fueling the car with nitromethane, getting it ready for that battle for the Winston World Championship title. Let's go to Steve.
Well, Mark Oswald wasn't even around when funny cars and dragsters smoked the tires on purpose, but that's what it felt like. You had to use the throttle.
Oh, yeah, it kicked him loose instantly, Steve.
Well, Paul Candies, the coroner, came down and said, that one was yours, kid. He's talking about your driving.
Yeah, I'm just glad to hang in there. You know, we're going to have to get tough and make an adjustment for that because we face Ed McCullough next round.
See you then.
Thank you.
Mark Oswald into the semifinals. More funny car racing next.
Kenny Bernstein has 3,000 horses under the hood. And Autolite spark plugs to make sure those horses fly. Kenny's crew chief, Dale Armstrong, always uses Autolite because they're durable and have copper in the seal. Autolite, the only plugs with a 2-year unlimited mileage guarantee. When Kenny's running for a championship, he knows what plugs will get him there.
Los Angeles County Fairgrounds in Pomona, California, at the NHRA Winston Finals. I'm Dave McClellan, along with Steve Evans, and a huge crowd of spectators on hand for this race that will decide the world championship in Top Fuel Eliminator. One of the competitors, Dick LaHaye, his crew, getting the car ready to go for this race against Joe Amato. His son Jeff, underneath the engine, replacing the oil pan.
And I'm sure way back in the pit area, they can hear the thunder from our next pair of AA fuel funny cars. It will be in the far lane, Scott Coletta up against Billy Meyer.
Coletta, part of that family operation that campaigns both this funny car and his dad's Top Fuel dragster. Meyer, meantime, out of the Chief Auto Parts sponsorship from Waco, Texas, uses an Oldsmobile Firenza body with a lot of the zoomy aerodynamics that we won't be seeing next season. Billy Meyer, in his first round race, defeated Tim Gross, while Scott Coletta beat the veteran Tom McEwen.
Scott Coletta's crew has grown by one as his father, Connie Coletta, defeated in Top Fuel, is now on the starting line looking on. And Dave, you talked about the zoomy body shape. That has been a big controversy in funny car racing this year. For next year, NHRA has changed the rules to try to bring these cars back to looking more like production automobiles. It's going to be quite a challenge for the racers. A lot of wind tunnel testing will go on during the offseason.
Coletta staging in the far lane, Meyer in the near lane. Coletta leaves a couple of days early. It is a red light start for Coletta. He left the starting line too soon, was disqualified. Billy Meyer was the automatic winner at the start, but he still thundered it through at a 5.54 second, 260 miles an hour. For Coletta, when he saw the red light, the race was over.
And back at the starting line, the body being laxed down over 4 times, funny car world champion Don the Snake Prideaux. This is the Pontiac's Gold Bandit Trans Am. Now Prudhomme idling up towards the burnout area. He'll get those tires good and wet, then move a few feet closer to the starting line, and then depress the throttle in high gear to smoke those tires. Wait a minute, the tires did not smoke. Don Prudhomme had a very poor burnout, and that could benefit this man, Dale Foley, in the In-N-Out Hamburgers car.
This car, owned by Bill Schultz, one of the most respected crew chiefs in the business, campaigns basically on the West Coast. It hardly travels anywhere but to Pomona, California, and a few Northern California racetracks. And Steve, that's what a burnout is supposed to look like and sound like. The motor in Baldy's car sounds great. In his first round race, he defeated Mike Dunn, the son of Jim Dunn, who we saw just a moment ago. Don Prudhomme defeated Jim Murphy in his first round confrontation.
Well, I assure you, the man in that Pontiac car is concerned right now. In the first round, he ran a career best of 5:44. But right now, without an adequate burnout, the advantage could go to Dale Foley, who's a former touring professional, as good a funny car driver as the sport has ever seen, and he will take full advantage if he can.
And in fact, Steve, Foley is in search of a full-time sponsorship that will allow him to resume the quest for the world championship title next season. A concerned Prudhomme at this moment. The car has not been able to even spin the tires in the water box. Underway with the staging. Foley in the far lane, Prudhomme near lane. Foley last to stage. Prudhomme's problems persist. He gets close to the center line. Foley wins the race. Dale Foley with a 5:51 elapsed time, 260 miles an hour, lays away the snake, who could only muster a 6:43 in this second round race. Our semifinals, a funny car eliminator by Dale Foley against Ed McCulloch. By virtue of McCulloch's quicker elapsed time in the second round, he has the choice of lane. What a race we have here. Billy Meyer against Mark Oswald. Meyer had the lane choice. Back in the pits, the countdown is on for Top Fuel Eliminator. It'll be Joe Amato against Dick LaHaye for the title world champion and the $100,000 season-ending bonus. Crew chief Tim Richards and Joe Amato directing the preparation of that race car. Meantime, Steve?
Well, for a guy like Dale Foley, who's been off the national event circuit for a couple of years, it's got to feel really good to come out here with a little old car and your home track and run a 5:51 in the heat of the day.
We're pretty happy with it. We wanted to run a 40-something, but as long as we got through the round, we'll go up and sneak up on it from there.
And McCulloch, I'm sure, knows that you're going to have lane choice.
Well, that's great. That's the first time in a while.
You're having fun, aren't you?
I'm having an enjoyable time, really a good time, a good group of guys to race with, and I think I've probably got the best tuner there is, Bill Schultz.
Indeed. Are you still trying to put together an effort to go back full-time to this?
You bet. I've got all the equipment, everything ready to go race, just need a sponsor.
Okay. Dale Foley, what a job he does.
Steve, we certainly look forward to the full-time return of Dale Foley. We'll be right back to the Winston Finals. In part by Budweiser. Beechwood aged for that distinctively clean, crisp taste that makes Budweiser the king of beers. Darryl Gwynn's out of the hunt for the world championship title, but he wants to win this race. His crew hard at work getting the race car ready for the semifinal.
And it's time now for pro stock. And accomplishing the burnout is Reed Wisnant in the beautiful black Camaro. His opponent in the far lane will be the Chevrolet Beretta of Joe Lapone. And of course, Dave, some of the closest racing in all the sport happens in this category. And even though Bob Gwynn has already clinched the world championship, this crowd is still excited anytime they see these factory hot rods.
Driving the Joe Paper Chevy Beretta, Joe Lapone defeated Darrell Alderman in his first round race. Meantime, Reed Wisden driving the RW Chevy Camaro beat Joe Campanello.
There's no nitro in these fuel tanks. It's 114-octane, $5-a-gallon racing gasoline fed through two four-barrel carburetors. The cars are 2,350 pounds weight with the driver on board, and they're busy in these machines shifting four-speed transmissions. That's Joe Lapone, last to stage. And a terrific lead by both drivers. Joe Lapone with his nose out in front over the far lane. Beretta far lane, Camaro near lane. It is Joe Lapone. Identical elapsed time, 7:51. Lapone on the starting line made the difference.
Steve, let's take a look at this race again. Joe Lapone's ability to drive that Chevy Beretta off the starting line is what paid off in this race. He had a big advantage the moment he let the clutch out. Reed Winston was behind from the start. He continued to remain in second place as Joe Lapone pulled ahead and by approximately a car length defeated Reed Winston.
Well, Joe Lapone got out of the car laughing and dancing around. He said, I wanted that one bad. Why this particular one?
Well, as close as the Winston World's points chase has been, every round we go here means a lot. Reed and I had to get by Reed to get ahead of him in points. I think we moved ahead of a couple other people, and we need to get back in the semis and close this year off well, you know.
751.
It was a pretty good run. I was real happy.
Okay, we'll see you next round.
Thank you very much.
Joe Lapone, one of the most personable drivers in all of motorsports. He heads over to shake hands and offer condolences to Reed Winston. On the starting line, it's another Chevy Beretta. This the Levi Garrett special of the team of Brayer and Morrison. They're racing against the Oldsmobile Forenza of Gary Brown out of Buford, Georgia. Brown is not only a championship race driver, he also owns Atlanta Dragway, the site of the NHRA Southern National.
In round number one, it was Gary Brown getting around Kenny Delco to advance to round two. Bruce Allen defeated Jerry Haas to get to this point in the competition.
Here is a struggle between two General Motors makes. The Oldsmobile in the far lane utilizes an Oldsmobile engine complete with cylinder block and cylinder heads. It is a race engine out of the Oldsmobile division. Meantime, Allen's car is powered by a 500 cubic inch big block Chevrolet. Great start for Gary Brown. Oh, what a hole shot. The advantage off the starting line goes to Brown. He holds on all the way through and outruns Bruce Allen. 7.50 seconds. His speed 185 miles an hour. The best Allen could get, a 7.54. What do we mean by a hole shot? Just look at Gary Brown in the far lane. The hole shot is the advantage you gain off the starting line. He had a tremendous leave on Bruce Allen. He parlayed that into a mid-course lead, and then as the two vehicles approached the finish line, that Oldsmobile continued to pull ahead. He not only beat him off the starting line, he beat him through the track.
Well, Gary Brown, one of your best races ever, a 750, and you left on one of the best in the business, Bruce Allen.
Well, he's tough, and we knew, you know, we were going to have a lot, and the round before, we both ran identical. He won a 51 with a 4, I won a 51 with a 7. So it was whoever was going to have the lead. So I understand I went a little quicker than he did anyway. So.
You did indeed.
So I'll take them as they go.
Terrific.
Next round.
Okay.
So it's Gary Brown. We'll look forward to seeing him and his flying Oldsmobile in the semifinals of Pro Stock. In Top Fuel Eliminator, the attention has been concentrated on the World Championship chase. But remember, there is another race in that semifinal. It will be Darrell Gwynn against the driver of this disassembled vehicle, Eddie Hill. The group are back together for the semifinal race at the Winston Finals. Area at the Winston Finals in Pomona, California. The crew going through the procedures of checking not only the engine, but the clutch and transmission, the drivetrain in this sophisticated 3,000 horsepower funny car.
And while they're working, the second round of Pro Stock Eliminator continues. That is the beautiful Pontiac Trans Am of Nick Nicholas. Nicholas will be in the near lane. His opponent in the far lane will be the famed Oldsmobile of Warren Johnson.
Last year, WJ finished number 2 in the World Championship points chase. This year, he got off to a great start, winning the Winter Nationals on this very same racetrack, but then fell off the pace just a bit and had to settle for the number 4 spot in the World Championship Series.
The Pro Stockers do a stationary wet burnout, then pull to the starting line for a long dry burnout, almost half track. In round number one, it was this man, Nick Nicholas out of Jackson Heights, New York, defeating Gordy Rivera. Warren Johnson with the Oldsmobile from Duluth, Georgia. He got by Lee Dean.
Johnson and Nicholas into the staging procedures. We're in round number two of Pro Stock Eliminator. Warren Johnson in the far lane of the racetrack, creeping forward in that Mr. Goodwrench Oldsmobile. Now both drivers are set in what is known as the pre-stage position. They're just a few inches away from the actual starting line. They're ready. A good start. And Warren Johnson is out first. Warren Johnson beats Nick Nicholas to the finish line. A 7.48 second elapsed time. Nicholas was close. 7.50 was his time. But WJ had the advantage off the starting line, and it paid off at the end of the quarter mile. Here's the guy that's won them all. He is aiming for his 60th National event victory with this race, this is the reigning world champion, Bob Glidden. Not only has Glidden and his Motorcraft Thunderbird amassed a tremendous number of victories, he has also qualified in the number one spot for 22 consecutive races. Steve?
Well, the first thing Warren Johnson did when he got out of his car, he ran back to check his parachute. It was all tangled up around the wheelie bars, a little tough to stop that way.
Yeah, I guess you'd call it a brake test of some sort.
A 7:48, a performance test. Good run.
Not as good as we've run out here, but I'm satisfied as long as we can win with it.
Indeed, that's the name of the game. Warren Johnson goes to the semis. That's going to be star-packed.
Steve, that semifinal round could include Jerry Ekman out of Ventura, California, driving Bill Orndorff's Chevy Camaro. This is an independent team, has no major sponsorship, but they have qualified well in the first round. They defeated Tony Christian. To make it to the semis, they have to get past Bob Glidden, who came to this race as the Winston World Champion for the unprecedented eighth time. And now, the man from Whiteland, Indiana, faces off with Jerry Ekman in the second round here at the Winston Finals. The Ford Thunderbird versus the Chevrolet Camaro. They are both pre-staged, inching forward. Who will move into the beams first? Awful lot of drivers like the stage last. Glidden will have that opportunity right now. They're ready, the RPM's up, and leaving too soon is Jerry Ekman. Bob Glidden's performance put so much pressure on these drivers, so many of them run light against him. The dominant force in Pro Stock Racing, that's Bob Glidden and the Ford Thunderbird into the semifinals with a great 7.42 second elapsed time, his speed 185 miles an hour. That time will give him the choice of lanes in the semifinal race against the Oldsmobile of Gary Brown. The other match in the semifinals will find Joe Lapone racing Warren Johnson, Chevy against Olds, the Oldsmobile with the choice of lanes. Steve Evans.
Bob Glidden out of the Ford Thunderbird, a 7:42 sends you to the semis.
We slowed down a little bit that round, Steve. Had a little bit of wheel hop in second gear. The sun's out, the track's really hot, and I think all the cars slowed down a little bit.
You know, with all the races you've won, the world championship again yours, but there's still another milestone at this race, isn't there?
Well, of course, every race is another milestone for us. I think the milestone you're referring to is this would be the 60th national event win in NHRA. That is a milestone, but more important than that is this is the world's finals. This is the last race of the season. This is the one we remember last, and so does everyone else.
Okay. See you in the semis.
Thanks, Steve.
Bob Glidden, the world champion. Another world championship title was decided earlier today on this racetrack. The Castrol GTX Pro Stock Motorcycle World Championship. Terry Vance in the near lane was running against Rick Jarrow in the second round of competition. Vance redlined. That gave the world championship title to David Schultz from Fort Myers, Florida. Schultz had come into this race leading in the points chase. The red light for Vance gave him the title.
Dave Schultz, congratulations on winning the Castrol GTX Motorcycle Championship. A great job.
Well, thank you. Right now I have a dry mouth and wet hands. It's hard to explain the emotion I feel right now.
You know, this Pro Stock class has come so far in the last few years.
Yes, it has. I really feel like we've gone leaps and bounds in putting on a good show and having it good and competitive. We run very tight, close races, and we're going fast now, too.
And judging by the appearance of this Kawasaki Ninja, you all take great pride in your equipment. The people come by in the pits, they see a motorcycle show as well.
Oh, very definitely. We feel like we're not only racers, we're showmen.
Okay, congratulations again.
Thank you.
sophisticated equipment, talented riders. David Schultz, the Pro Stock Motorcycle World Champ. On the starting line in Pomona, California, there is tension in the air. $100,000 riding on a single run. After a season-long series of events, it comes down to the battle between Joe Amato and Dick LaHaye.
We just saw Joe's wife, Jerry, offering encouraging words and I'm sure trying to be a calming influence. And the same thing is going on in the staging lane with Dick LaHaye and one of the women in his life, his daughter and crew chief Kim. Kim offering some final thoughts on the racing surface and also taking a final tug on the shoulder straps as Dick LaHaye is strapped in to meet Joe Amato.
It's a very good idea from time.
At the NHRA Winston Finals of the Los Angeles County Fairgrounds, I'm Dave McClelland along with Steve Evans, and one whole season has boiled down to this in Top Fuel Eliminator. The race for the Winston World Championship title between this man, Joe Amato. He's checking over to see if his competitor has got the engine started. He is racing against Dick LaHaye.
The two have met side by side five times this season. Dick LaHaye has won three of those encounters. Amato hopes to even the score. To know what was going through the mind of Dick LaHaye right now, Dave McClelland, I have a feeling it's take it easy, calm down, don't make a mistake. Both drivers probably thinking that now.
We have seen in our pre-race interviews both drivers very calm and collected considering what's up for grabs. And that, of course, is $100,000 riding on a single run. But Dick LaHaye must remember that in the previous round, he smoked the tires when he left the starting line. Will that loss of traction problem plague him here? It is now in the hands of the drivers. A few moments ago, it was up to the crew chief.
The engine essentially back together in the Joe Amato car. Crew chief Tim Richards, you've given Joey a very consistent car for two rounds. Your thoughts as you race for the world championship?
Well, I feel as though that this is definitely the biggest run of our career, Joe and mine and everybody else here. And it's real important to stay consistent on this track. The track seems to be going away a little bit, but we've got to go for it. I have to figure that LaHaye has maybe a 17 or a 16 in his car, and we just have to go for it. I don't feel as though we're in a real good position here because we've been making a little too much heat in this car, and LaHaye isn't. So it's a lot easier for him to step up than it is us. We're trying to back up at the same time we're trying to go fast. It's not a good situation.
Well, the situation here is that Dick LaHaye's daughter Kim is going to try to give her father a dragster that won't smoke the tires and will get a hold of the racetrack. Kim, your feelings, the world championship on the line.
Well, we're just going to try to run the best that we can, and hopefully it won't smoke the tires. And whatever the outcome is, we're real happy with the year.
The intensity of the moment etched into the face of Kim LaHaye. The two drivers getting set for the most important 5 seconds of their racing career.
And two distinctively different personalities. Seated in the TRW special, Joe Amato, who wears his emotions on his fingertips. Across the way in the Miller American, soft-spoken Dick LaHaye, but you never know what is churning inside the man.
45-year-old Dick LaHaye has been a drag racing driver all of his adult life. Years filled with struggle. But Joe Amato came up through the sportsman ranks. He's already won a world championship title. In fact, practically everything Joe Amato touches turns to gold.
Dick LaHaye is the last to stage the way he likes it in the rock.
Joe Amato has problems. Dick LaHaye hits to the finish line and is the world champion. Single run, the crew checking down track, making sure LaHaye makes the turnoff and is safe and okay.
The crew expressing some concern in the starting line, David. We can tell them from down here that Dick LaHaye is A-okay and one happy man, and we'll talk to him soon.
With the resounding cheers of a standing ovation from this huge crowd, the Dick LaHaye family heads down track to meet up with the new Winston World Champion. This crowd reflecting the emotion of the moment as we relive it again. You see Joe Amato get a very slight advantage at the start, and then something goes wrong. Joe Amato's engine backfires, a flash of flame smoke out of the header, and he watches Dick LaHaye disappear towards the finish line. As the crew heads down track to meet up with Dick LaHaye, let's go to Steve Evans and meet the new Winston World Champ.
For the first time in his 30-year racing career, a world championship, the Winston World Championship, and $100,000 belongs to this man, Dick LaHaye, 519.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you very much. I'm almost lost for words.
You know, Dan Henley, the team manager for Winston, is busy taping your name on this check. It's a monstrous check for a monstrous amount of money, my friend.
Well, thank you. It just, you know, we smoked the tires in the round before, and both the Miller cars were out there racing each other, and we were going to go for it, and I told Larry, I said, stand on the gas, because I'm racing you. And just smoked the tires, and I'll be truth with you, he gave me that round.
This particular race, tell me, did you see him, Otto? Did you see his problems?
I never seen him, no. We just left, and I just kept hoping and praying to the Lord that he'd never see a wheel, and I never seen him.
I hear a horn honking. Do we have any idea who could possibly be behind the wheel of that truck?
It's probably Team LaHaye, and Kim's leading them.
Indeed it is. Kim LaHaye, the entire LaHaye family roaring down here to take a look at what has to be the most amount. You never dreamed in your wildest days that drag racing could have that kind of reward.
Never. I mean, you know, when we started this almost 30 years ago, we was lucky to race for $500. Now it's $100,000.
Kim LaHaye, you're thrilled, I know.
Oh, sure did. It worked good.
Congratulations.
Thank you,
look,
Steve.
At this, guys, right there.
Congratulations, Nicole.
Thank Joe you. Amato.
I hear you, man.
I know.
Thank you.
A fiery finish to one of the best world championship battles ever.
Truly spoken, Steve Evans. Our congratulations to Dick LaHaye, the world champion. On the starting line, the final pair in the semifinal round, shading his eyes from the sun, is Daryl Gwynn. Gwynn is racing against the national speed record holder. That's Eddie Hill in the far lane of the racetrack. Thus, we find the quickest car in the world, Daryl Gwynn, against the fastest.
And both of these drivers, Dave, next season may have a tremendous impact on who wins the world championship. It could be either one of them, for that matter. It's going to be quite a season coming up next year. But right now, we've got a race to finish. There's still over $20,000 to be won. Daryl Gwynn, the car shaking and vibrating, rocking on those huge rear slicks. He is pre-staged and staged. Eddie Hill finally moves in.
And Hill with the advantage, and some problems on Hill's engine, but he stays with it. The flame continued to come out on Eddie Hill. But for Daryl Gwynn, he advances to the finals to race against the new world champion, Dick LaHaye. Eddie Hill gave it everything he had. He had the advantage at the start as we look again. You can see Hill's car in the far lane. It moved first. Then the flames began to pour out from around the engine. Eddie Hill kept his foot in the throttle, but Daryl Gwynn had started to pull alongside by mid-course. At the finish line, Daryl Gwynn had built up a considerable lead. The flames continued to come from the engine of Eddie Hill. He was forced to shut it off, and Daryl Gwynn moves into the finals against Dick LaHaye, and Gwynn has the choice of lane.
And David, I can tell you that down here at the end of the racetrack, the world championship celebration continues. But Dick LaHaye is going to have to get that crew together back to the pits and prepare his car to race Daryl Gwynn in the final.
This is one of the most unusual schools around, a school for drag racing. And Frank Hawley, who runs it, pushes drivers and cars to the limit. That's why he uses parts that can take a lot of pressure, like Fram oil filters. He knows with a cheap brand there could be problems, like leaking gaskets and maybe even big engine trouble. So Frank thinks it's worth paying a little more for a Fram oil filter. After all, isn't it better to spend a little now instead of a lot later?
At the Winston Finals in Pomona, California, we have seen a world champion crowned in top fuel racing, but there is a lot of competition left at this event. This is Dale Baldy. Driving the Oldsmobile-bodied Funny Car, he'll be racing against Ed McCulloch in the semifinals of Funny Car Eliminator.
Now, normally, you might expect a car like Foley's driving to be an underdog compared to a machine like the Oldsmobile of Ed McCulloch. But consider Foley in the round before ran a 5:51. Hold it. There is a problem with Foley's car. In fact, it is shut off down track at the end of the burnout. The car expired, and Foley is climbing out. This one will belong to Ace McCulloch.
What a break for McCulloch in the semifinals, and Baldy is unhappy. You saw him wave at that race car, displaying his anger. Dale Baldy out of competition for the day. That cheer you hear in the background is not for Baldy as much as he would like it. It is for the new world champion. This is Dick LaHaye. He gets a chance to hear the cheers as he heads back to the pit area in his triumphant return to prepare for the final round of this Winston Finals against Daryl Gwynn.
All day long, this has been a very nonpartisan crowd. The cheers were equal for LaHaye and Amato. But now that Dick has won it, the crowd has adopted the family from Michigan.
Ed McCulloch has got to be thinking about a good elapsed time. Why? The better your ET, as long as it's ahead of your opponent, you have the lane choice in the respective round. He's going directly now into the final round. He wants a quick time. McCulloch got a tremendous start, and look at the wheel stand. McCulloch drove through a power wheel stand in the middle of the racetrack. His time, 5.48 seconds, 268 miles an hour. Tremendous experience and driving ability coming into play on Ed McCulloch's single. As we look again, you see the car leave the starting line. The front wheels were just dancing off the pavement at this point. And then the further he got down track, the higher the front end went up. Finally, the front end came back to earth in a four-point landing, and McCulloch's in the finals.
There are people in the grandstand still with their mouths hanging open. This reporter is in the same boat. Unbelievable wheel stand.
Well, left pretty good, but out there, Steven locked the clutch up and was hooked up good, and I mean, it put the front end up, and I needed lane choice real bad for next round, so I just hung with it, and it hung in there and went a long ways with the front end a long ways up, and what'd it run?
A 5.48.
Well, I'd like for it to run a little quicker than that.
But wait a minute, when that thing went up, you had to be staring right into the sun.
Yeah, no, it was up a long ways. It, you know, I mean, we...
Could you see any of the racetrack?
No, nothing. You know, out front of you is all you see is the hood. But, I mean, I could see to the side, and I mean, it was going straight, and so I just, you know, pedaled. I didn't come back off of it much, but just a little bit, and it carried there, and away we went.
On the starting line, the remaining two Funny Car semifinalists going into the burnout procedure. Billy Meyer out of Waco, Texas, has got some newfound performance. He may need it to try to catch this man, who has recorded the quickest lap time ever at this event in qualifying at 5.35 seconds. That's Mark Oswald.
In fact, that time is the quickest in Funny Car racing history. Remember earlier I said how nonpartisan the crowd was? Well, look at the ovation for Joe Amato. And even in defeat, Amato salutes the crowd. What a racer. What a man.
Believe me, Steve, this is not the last time we will be seeing Joe Amato.
I look forward to it. Right now, I look forward to the last half of the semifinals in Funny Car. How about Billy Meyer's performance ever since he signed on new crew chief David Settles? This car, instead of blowing superchargers and bodies off, is in the 540s, along with that man, Mark Oswald. I think we're seeing a harbinger of things to come next season. Cars like Meyer, cars like McCulloch, Oswald are going to give Bernstein a serious run for the title.
A serious race here for the right to face Ed McCulloch in the final. Oswald in the far lane, first to stage. Meyer and Oswald lead the starting line together. And it's so close at the finish, nobody knows who won. It was Billy Meyer. Thank goodness for electronic win judges, as Billy Meyer had a 5.46 second elapsed time to the losing 5.47 time by Mark Oswald. In replay, you can see the two cars leaving the starting line at almost the identical moment. It was a pick'em race at half track. Then, as they approached the finish line, it appeared Oswald had the lead, but at the very last moment, Billy Meyer pulled ahead to win and advanced to the finals to race against Ed McCulloch. Billy Meyer, with the 5.46, will have the lane choice.
Dave, both drivers scrambled from their cars, yelling, "Who won? Who won?" It was my pleasure to tell Billy Meyer he was headed for the finals.
For the second consecutive year, Budweiser Racing Teams captured three national championships. Bobby Rahal in the Bud IndyCar. Kenny Bernstein in the Budweiser King. And Jim Kropfeld in Miss Budweiser. It's a tradition of horsepower that keeps Budweiser ahead of the pack. Racing fans,
Angeles County Fairgrounds in Pomona, California, and the NHRA Winston Finals. This crowd has lost none of its enthusiasm as we head into the semifinals of Pro Stock Eliminator. On the starting line, we see our first pair getting ready to go. It is Warren Johnson in the far lane with the Oldsmobile Firenza. He's racing against Joe Lapone in the Chevy Beretta.
Warren Johnson is admired by his fellow competitors for his engineering ability, always developing something new. Joe LeBeau, well, I'll tell you, a lot of drivers are envious of his reaction times off the starting line, and he has proven that today he is indeed among the very tops in his field. That is the Chevy Beretta in the near lane, the Oldsmobile in the far lane. They inch forward to stage. You can see the wheels moving very slowly to position themselves exactly on the starting line. Finally in is Joe LeBeau, and a red light, a foul start for Warren Johnson. He may not even know it as he wastes a 7:46 elapsed time at 186 miles an hour. That has gone down the drain. Joe LeBeau, who had to fight his car down the near lane, cut almost a perfect light and wins with a 7:72 to head to the semifinals.
While these two cars turning off on the starting line, our next pair getting set. Another Oldsmobile. This is Gary Brown from Buford, Georgia, racing against the world champion Bob Glidden in the Ford Thunderbird. If there were to be picked a crowd favorite in pro stock racing nationwide, it is this man, Bob Glidden. He and his wife, Anna, along with their sons, Rusty and Billy, have climbed into prominence by the dint of hard work. The hours they spend developing and researching, trying to make more power out of that Ford engine.
Racing a GM Pro Stocker, you can buy most of the technology. Not the real speed secrets, but all the basics. Racing a Ford? Well, Glidden's the only one that does in NHRA racing. He has to develop every single thing himself. That's the hard work Dave McClellan was just referring to.
Steve, he does that in his own shop. It is a complex of buildings located outside of Indianapolis in the small suburb town of Whiteland, Indiana. That's where Bob Glidden comes from. That's where he finds his horsepower in the dark of the night.
All right, they are staged and ready. The green light flashes, and away first by a few hundredths of a second is Gary Brown in the far lane. Gary Brown giving Glidden everything he wants. Bob Glidden wins at 7:37, 182 miles an hour. What a game drive by Gary Brown. A 7:51 and 185 miles an hour. He actually ran just a little bit faster than the Ford.
That sets up our finals for Pro Stock Eliminator. It will be the Ford of Bob Glidden against the Chevrolet of Joe LeBeau. Glidden, with that great 7:37, earned himself the lane choice in the final. While the Fat Lady may have sung for the Winston World Championship title, for Dick LaHaye, one more race remains to make it a doubleheader weekend. He has got to defeat the national record-holding car of Darrell Gwynn. The LaHaye crew hard at work preparing that car for the final round race. Meantime, across the pit area, the same thing is going on in Darrell Gwynn's pit.
And over here, it's a very quiet, business-like atmosphere as all the parts are being pre-lubed to reassemble this monstrous 500 cubic inch racing engine. This machine is one of only six left in competition. The final professional categories are coming up.
At the Winston Finals in Pomona, California, Billy Meyer and his crew are hard at work as they prepared this car for the final round of Funny Car Eliminator. They had the engine completely reassembled, but they found pulled threads in the cylinder block. One of the studs had pulled the threads out of the block. They had to take it apart and repair it.
You know, earlier this weekend, also crowned were all of the Winston World Champions in NHRA sportsman categories. This was the final round among the top alcohol funny cars. In the far lane, former world champion Brad Anderson from Southern California. And in the near lane, the green and white Castro GTX car of Pat Austin from Tacoma, Washington. Austin had won the world championship coming in, now on the event title as well. A 6.21 did it. Our congratulations to Pat Austin, world champion alcohol funny car.
In addition to Pat Austin, in the sportsman category, six other Winston World Champions were crowned. In top alcohol dragster, Denny Lucas of Grand Junction, Colorado, won his first ever world champion title.
In competition eliminator, Bill Moropoulos of Simi Valley, California, campaigned his Beat Economy dragster to his second Winston World Championship in the category.
Another first-time Winston World Champion came from Richland, Washington. Jim Waldo wheeled a 67 Ford Fairlane into the victory circle in Stock Eliminator.
He's been racing that Ford since 1967. In the category of Super Gas, where driver ability is all important, Sheldon Gecker can be proud. He's from Milwaukee. He's the Winston World Champion.
driver ability counts in Super Comp Eliminator, and Steve Cohen from Clearwater, Florida, amassed the most points throughout the entire season of any racer in the Winston World Championship.
And in Superstock, the winner came from Coraopolis, Pennsylvania. His name, Jim Baburka. Congratulations to all. Well done.
It is time now for the finals in Pro Stock Eliminator. Joe Lapone drives the Chevrolet Beretta. He's got some history behind him. His crew chief is the famed Bill Grumpy Jenkins, but he's going to need everything to beat the man that wears the number one for eight times. He has won the Winston World Championship title, Bob Glidden, going against Lapone.
Neither wants to stage first. This is what we talked about earlier when you get two drivers obstinate about being last to stage. Glidden breaks. Lapone won that one.
And then he lost it. A red light on the starting line indicating Joe Lapone and the Beretta moved way too soon. That automatically gave the win to Bob Glidden. Lapone was disqualified at the start. The time for Glidden, 7.42 seconds, a bit slower than he has run all day at 178 miles an hour. And once again, Bob Glidden has won an NHRA national event title. This one came early in the race, right at the starting line. Joe Lapone left way too soon, making Bob Glidden the champ.
Well, that's it. Bob Glidden's 60th win in Pro Stock, a record I doubt will ever be broken. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Steve. The ending of a great season. We've simply had a phenomenal season, and this is, I guess, the way to end it. Not only the 60th national event win, but the eighth win of the season, which I think is a record that the boys have really strived to reach this year.
You know, I know you're not going to reveal any speed secrets, but why is it that one man, Bob Glidden, can so effectively campaign this Ford automobile?
Well, we get a lot of help from Ford, their engineers, and I think the main reason is that in the boys.
If someone was willing to work as hard as your family, could they run as well with a Thunderbird?
Absolutely. We're certainly not well-educated engineers. We're well-educated maybe as far as this race car is concerned, drag racing, the proof in winning is hard work and dedication.
See you next season.
Thank you very much, Steve.
No family does that better. Hard work and dedication. That is the credo of the Glidden family, and it has carried them to their eighth Winston World Championship title. A beautiful sunset over the Los Angeles County Fairgrounds as we come down to two remaining races at the Winston Finals. In Top Fuel Eliminator, Darrell Gwynn will race against Dick LaHaye. The emotion may be gone just a bit of the moment for Dick LaHaye, but Darrell Gwynn is riding a high. He has had some tremendous performances throughout this event. LaHaye, of course, has already clinched the world championship title. Now he would like to double it up and take home the event title as well. Interestingly, both these racing operations are founded on the family unit.
Now, you'd think a team who was about to make a six-figure bank deposit might relax a little bit, right? Wrong. Not if you're Dick LaHaye and family. The rear end has come out of the car. A brand new rear end has gone in. It apparently burned a bearing in that world championship race with Joe Amato. And you know, the work goes on. Things don't look a lot different, but the feeling is far different. Jeff LaHaye, there's smiles on everybody's faces now as you do this work.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's easy now. And I just thank the Lord so much for everything that he's given us. And unbelievable.
Now you're going to go after Darrell Gwynn just one more time.
Well, that's it. We got to go out on a winning note and just try to do the best we can.
You always do. Got to feel like somebody took a sandbag off your shoulders, huh?
Oh, yeah. The pressure's really off now. And we just try to go out there and do the best we can for the next run.
Is it still fun?
Absolutely.
Thank you. Okay. Jeff LaHaye and family. And in the pits of Dick LaHaye's competition in the final round, it's another family operation. But here it's the offspring, Darrell Gwynn, who drives, and Father Jerry, who oversees things. And Jerry, obviously, you've proven you've got a handle on all things mechanical, low ET of the event. But you know, this year we've noticed a real maturity in Darrell.
Well, I think so. I think as the year progresses and the years go on, he'll progress even more.
I mean off the track as well as on.
Oh, I think so. I think a little bit of that goes, with the running all the older fellows and doing the best he can do.
Getting a little more worldly, as they say.
Yeah, for sure.
Is there still a father-son relationship here? Is it more kind of pals and racers?
Well, it's like a father-son, brother. I mean, he's He's like a brother to me, you know. Anything that he needs, I'm right there to help him, or vice versa.
Good luck in the final. Should be a nice race.
Thank you very much.
The 26-year-old Darryl Gwynn still relying heavily on that relationship with his father, the traditional handshake before the race.
And you can say goodbye to both of these race cars, Dave. It's the last time they will traverse the quarter mile. Both teams already have brand new cars for next season. But what thrills both of those long, sleek dragsters have given us.
In the far lane, Darryl Gwynn, Dick LaHaye in the near lane. Neither driver anxious to stage. Gwynn makes the move first. Now, LaHaye into the beams. LaHaye's got the advantage at the start, but Darryl Gwynn drives right past it. And Darryl Gwynn is the Winston Finals champion. Look at the elapsed time, 5.13 seconds. His speed, 276 miles an hour. LaHaye fell off pace. The car left the starting line very strongly, but then almost instantly, some problems set in for Dick LaHaye. That slowed his race car, and Darryl Gwynn just squirted past him and went on straight to the finish line to take a substantial victory over the world champion. Darryl Gwynn wins the Winston Finals.
Well, Darryl Gwynn continues his love affair with this quarter mile in Pomona, California. First the Winter Nationals and now the Winston Finals event title. Congratulations. A 5:13.
Thank you very much. We knew LaHaye was going to be right there. I'm not sure what happened to him in the final, but we knew he was going to be right there, and we made some major changes for this thing in the final to try and get down this tricky racetrack. But no matter what, I don't care if somebody oiled that left lane down in front of me, I was going to take that left lane because I've won this race here two or three times in that left lane. I was going to take it.
Happy bunch of kids behind you who help an awful lot on this car. And a lot of people think, well, they'll all take a month off and go somewhere. You start testing in 2 weeks on a new car.
That's exactly right, Steve. And the car's sitting here in L.A. at a bare chassis, and we've got to race it in 2 weeks. We've got our work cut out for us, but we're definitely not going to put this car in the back burner. It's going to be upstairs in our new trailer.
All right. Darryl Gwynn, he'll be tough next year with a brand new and lighter race car.
Steve, a great deal of happiness in the Gwynn family operation as Dad Jerry comes over to offer the congratulations so well and richly deserved by the Winston Finals champ. The Winston Finals in Pomona, California has one race left. The Funny Car Championship still at stake. And this crowd has not budged. A huge throng of people watching intently as Ed McCulloch and Billy Meyer get set to square off for the Funny Car Championship.
Well, it's a good thing they're fired and ready, Dave, or we'd have to put driving lights on these cars. The sun isn't setting. It is running away. Billy Meyer's crew was able to repair that broken head stud, and they're confident that that will not be a problem. At the Ace McCullough in the far lane, what a Joey Chipwood thrill show he has put on for us today with that incredible wheel stand to get him this far.
Meyer comes into this race with the choice of lanes by just a few hundredths of a second. It's a good start. Instantly up in smoke goes McCullough. And look at Meyer streaking to the finish line. 5.47 seconds, continuing the performance dominance that Billy Meyer has enjoyed throughout eliminations. For Ed McCulloch, what a disappointment. The car losing traction right at the starting line. As we look again, you can see Meyer in the near lane hitting the throttle just a hundredth of a second or so quicker than Ed McCulloch. But McCulloch's car lost the traction, the smoke coming out the back, indicating the sliding tires, and Billy Meyer crosses the finish line a winner.
Billy Meyer out of his race car with his second win of the season. A string of 540s pulled it off, a 547 on the final. Nice shot.
Yeah, that was a quick between rounder that time with the dark coming on. Oh, me.
It is dark. Any problems, Sing?
Not in the final round. Doesn't really matter. They have header flames, you can see that way.
No, I don't think I've ever heard two funny cars sound any better than you and the Ace did up there, just pounding the ground.
Well, they ran well all week, and they've been running real good for a long time. And, you know, Dave and them, everybody in the crew knew that we had to have the car ready. We had some problems back there with a broken head stud, so we just were trying to get up there as quick as we could.
You know, I have a feeling that Kenny Bernstein can expect a much bigger challenge next year than he had this year for that Winston World title.
Oh, there's no doubt about it. He was 6 months ahead of us, and they're still running a little bit better than everybody, but they're not as consistent because they're probably testing. But there's a lot of us running a lot better, and everybody seems, you know, it's made everybody try harder, and our crew is trying harder than ever, and with all our sponsors like Chief and everybody pushing us to win, you know, it helps. So it's just nice to end the year like that. You can go into the winter.
Indeed it is. Congratulations again. A great show.
Thank you.
Billy Meyer, the Funny Car Champion.
Our congratulations to all the Winston Finals champions. Daryl Gwynn in Top Fuel, Billy Meyer in Funny Car, and in Pro Stock, Bob Flynn. For Steve Evans, I'm...